You know what you guys have to add?
What?
You guys have to add like you've been social distancing for 2 months. That's what you have.
I was still here.
We're not recording. Hey, real quick, you heard the announcement from Sarah about July 4th. The city of Eagle Point is not having a parade or fireworks or anything. And we just thought, you know what? Whoever wants to come and get together on July 4th, we'll be able to have a little barbecue and just kind of get together and have some fun. And so if you can make it, great. We'll be here at the church. That's a Saturday, I believe, and I think it's from 11 to 2. And then if you have any prayer chain needs, if you'd like to be on the prayer chain or have somebody to add to the prayer chain, you can talk to Flo, give her a call. Her number's in the bulletin. Also, let's see, Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, come, we'll feed you, or you can bring something and you can feed yourself. Pop up there, and then Bible study is at 6:45. We meet till about 8, and we are currently in Genesis chapter about 17 or 18 or 20. Katie is trying to tell me something, but I don't know. 20? 21. I think she's reading ahead, but I'm not sure.
It's 20.
It's 20. Okay. Somebody asked me about making an announcement before service. Is that you, PK?
Well, I can.
Okay, well, go ahead.
It's the men's brunch.
Men's brunch, okay.
We're having a men's brunch.
I got it.
You got it? Okay.
I got it.
I practice
this. You practice this?
No,
I'll
call her. I'll be loud. We were talking about having a hot dog get together, you know, and then he came out of what do you call it?
What's that?
Hot dog go down?
Hot dog go down.
Yeah, we went to a little bit of Peter Neener and Grand River Fantasmagorical Festival. Dog Crowd, Chili Dog Chase, and Two Sig Rodeo, and Kenya. Whatever you think you'd call it. Next Saturday about 11 o'clock for the guys. And bring your guns, you know, just leave your wives and sweethearts for the night. That's the only requirement.
Are you cooking?
Yeah.
Oh.
One quick addition.
Yeah.
I have written a phenomenal sermon called The Right Side of the Boat. It's all about which side you're fishing off of. And why aren't you catching any fish? So don't miss it. Okay,
and
again, no girls
about. They're on the wrong side of the boat.
Okay. Yes.
Anyhow, we're going to have everything you can think of to put on the
boat. I was already at the church at 11 o'clock next Saturday. So what are you going to do about that?
Inviting the church kids. So grandkids, kids.
do that. So it's at my house. You can give me a call. I'm just right down the road, not too very far. And the date is in time.
Perfect. Thank you. Let's take her off the show. Also, another announcement. I knew there was another announcement. Pastor Jim, because he's wearing a suit, there's going to be a short meeting of the security team after church in the fellowship room. So that's today. Okay? Just short, and Jim will have some things to say. So, Lord God, we just pray that you will bless this offering, that this community might be energized by your word through us. Lord, help us, Lord God, to fulfill whatever destiny you have for us as a church here in this community. We do pray that you will help us in our country, help our president, convict all of our elected officials to do your will. Lord, please bless our servicemen and women, and grant them Christian fellowship wherever they're stationed. We pray that, Lord God, you start a great revival in this country, and may it begin right here with us. We give you the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
The Beatles came out with a song
Top Revolution. And I used the words the other day, and it was actually a pretty good song. It talked about a revolution, but a peaceful one. And a fellow by the name of Charles Manson, who is certainly inhabited by the devil, he took that in 1969 and decided to make start a race war with it. It's the name of the war was Helter Skelter. And we're seeing in our country today really what is bordering on a revolution. We really are. And, you know, there's been many, many revolutions throughout history. There's revolutions in countries, there's sexual revolutions, there's drug revolutions, there was a revolution in the 60s, there's been all kinds of different revolutions, some good and some not so good. And when we think about revelation, we're thinking about revealing divine truth to humans. When we think about redemption, we're thinking about liberation. Liberation by a payment, i.e. Jesus' death on the cross. When we think about revolution, we're thinking about an overthrow or a renunciation of one government and substituting another by the governed. And that's what we're seeing today. We're seeing a revolution trying to happen in the United States of America, as well as the world. And this revolution isn't necessarily, I don't believe anyway, as much a racial revolution as it is a political revolution. I think that the very fabric, the very history, the very norms and standards of the United States of America are threatened and want to be overthrown by a certain few. And, you know, we look at the television and we see the rioting, we see the revolt, we see all this stuff, and we think that it is a localized revolt, but it really isn't. This is a political revolt that goes up into the highest echelons of power and money. And I want to talk to you about what Jesus said in the word to us about what is going to happen. Satan wants the United States of America to fall. Alright? Why? Well, I'll tell you why. Because we are one of the last bastions of freedom. Free will. Freedom to worship. Freedom to say what's on your mind. Good or bad? And the one world system that Satan wants to put together is being hindered at this point by the United States of America and by our president and present administration, because I'm speaking of Donald Trump, is not really a politician. We've seen that pretty plainly, okay? And for the good or for the bad, he is really not playing politics the way politics are used to be played. And for us, hopefully that will turn out to be a good thing, because politics as usual have gotten kind of political. Does that make sense? This is what Psalm 94:16 says. Who will rise up for me against the wicked? Who will take a stand for me against evildoers? Who will take a stand for me against evildoers? Well, we know that Jesus Christ not only has, but he will. And we as Christians should take a stand against evil, whatever evil we see. In Genesis chapter 6, you don't have to turn there, to read you a scripture. Listen to what God said about that particular generation right before the flood. The Lord saw how great man's wickedness on the earth had become, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil all the time. That's pretty bad. The wickedness had become so evil that every inclination of the thoughts of mankind's heart was only evil all the time. The Lord was grieved that he had made man on the earth, and his heart was filled with pain. So the Lord said, I will wipe mankind who I have created from the face of the earth. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Turn to Matthew chapter 24 if you would like to. We have studied Matthew 24 before. Matthew 24, Luke 21, and Mark chapter 13 all record the same event, but from a slightly different viewpoint. Jesus Christ and his disciples were on the Mount of Olives, and it was getting close to the time when Jesus would die. They were looking across the ravine at the temple. The temple was one of the great magical type of buildings of that century. It was certainly one of the wonders of the world. I don't know if you knew this or not, but gold covered many of the stones in the temple. It was quite a sight to see. And Jesus is there with his disciples in Matthew chapter 24. And what I want to do with you today is I want to take Mark 13, Luke 21, and Matthew 24 and put them in a synopsis so you can understand them all as one scripture. Also, I want to explain to you from the original language what Jesus was talking about when he said, you will see these signs. Now, in verse 1, Jesus left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to its buildings. Do you see all these things? He asked. Jesus is speaking. I tell you the truth, not one stone here will be left on another. Every stone will be thrown down. Now you can imagine the disciples' dismay at this. I mean, this was the epicenter for Jewish worship. This was, Herod had remodeled the Jewish temple and had increased its size, and it was literally one of the wonders of the world. And Jesus said, prophesied to his disciples, that in a short period of time, in fact, in less than 40 years when Jesus said this, he said, every stone will be thrown down. Now, why did that happen? Well, the Romans came in. The Jews had rejected Jesus Christ as their Savior. And God had told them that that was the end. God's patience had run out at that point in history with the Jews, with the nation of Israel. And he had told them many times that you will go into captivity, which they had done many times. And when Titus came in, the Roman general, with his Roman troops, surrounded the city of Jerusalem and basically starved the people out, when he went in, built a ramp, and he went into the city, he murdered, he killed, he looted. The Romans killed literally thousands and thousands and thousands of Jewish people. Not only did they do that, but they looted, of course, any riches. They took the temple, and what happened is that there was a fire that started in the temple, and the fire started melting gold that had adorned the different accoutrements of the temple, and the gold melts at approximately well, it's a fairly high temperature, but this was a big fire, and the gold started dripping down. And so what they did is that they removed every stone that the temple was built with to get to the gold that had dripped down between the stones. So Jesus' prophecy had come true after, of course, he had died and risen and gone to be with his Father. And so the disciples and Jesus are sitting there, and Jesus is telling them this. As Jesus, verse 3, was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? The disciples were expecting this to be a short thing with Jesus being gone. He had already told them that he must go to see the Father. And he said, if I go, I will come again and I will fetch you so that you can be where I am. And so the disciples basically thought that this was going to be a fairly short thing. Well, this has been now almost 2,000 years since Jesus has said these words. The Bible tells us that a day with the Lord is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. Now, what does that mean? Basically, if you take the most simplest meaning of it, that's this: God's patience is very, very, very long. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should find him. Now, so Jesus says this. Jesus answered in verse 4. He answered the question. Remember, the question is this: when will this happen? And what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age? That's the question. Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name claiming I am the Christ and will deceive many. So the first sign is deception. I don't know if you knew this or not, but deception or deceive is mentioned in the Bible at least 77 times. To deceive means to cause to roam from truth, or to go astray, or to seduce into another belief. So basically what Jesus was saying is, be very careful that no one seduces you into another belief or causes you to roam from the faith. This was the very first thing that Jesus said. We have a satanic deception. Eve was deceived by Satan. He told her, if you disobey God, of course he didn't put it that way, if you eat of the fruit of this tree, you will be like God, knowing good and evil. She bit. Literally, she bit on not only the whatever the fruit was, but she bit on that temptation, and so did Adam, and we see the results of that today. There's worldly deception. The deception of the world, I mean, all you gotta do is look at TV and see the deception. It's just amazing. Look at the Oscars. You know, these people get up there and they parade around like they're something, like they love each other. But let me tell you something. They'll cross each other the first time that comes across. Another thing is self-induced deception. The Bible very clearly tells us, don't deceive yourselves. Don't think more of yourselves than what you ought to think. What does it say? If a man thinks he stands, he should take heed lest he fall. Listen to what 1 John chapter 4 says. And I want to read this because this is pretty amazing. John writes this almost 2,000 years ago, and it applies today just as equally as it did then. Listen to what John, 1 John chapter 4, verse 1 to 6 says. John speaking. Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. Now, he gives us a little formula here. This is how how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world, and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us, but whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. The test, the litmus test for whether a spirit is from God or not, is all about who Jesus is. That's the litmus test. Jesus is the Son of God. This is true. But Jesus is God come in the flesh. That's what John chapter 1, verse 1, all the way to verse 14 says. He was with God in the beginning, and he was God. God miraculously impregnated a virgin with his own seed. Jesus Christ was born the God-man. Okay? God was his father, and still is, and Mary was his mother. Mary is not the mother of God. She's the mother of the humanity of Jesus Christ. Now, so, deception is the very first thing that Jesus mentions. The second thing that he mentions is wars. This is the word polema, or polemos, and it means armed hostilities. I looked online, and there are at least 40 wars going on today throughout the world, at least 40. Now, what I want to show you, or what I want you to think about, is this. When Jesus spoke this, were there wars? Absolutely. Were there deception? Absolutely. Were there revelations? Certainly. Famines, earthquakes, certainly. But they were not at the same scale or the same intensity as we have today. Now, we're going to see that here. So the first thing is deception. The second thing is wars. Jesus says this. Let me turn to it, get back to my Matthew chapter 24. He says, Jesus answered, "Watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name claiming I am the Christ, and will deceive many." You know, it's interesting. I looked up yesterday online how many people have claimed to be Jesus Christ. There was a lot of them. There was a lot of them. The three that I picked out, you'll recognize because they are in our era. The first one was Jim Jones of the People's Temple. He claimed to be Jesus Christ. The next one was, and not necessarily in order, but the next one was David Koresh of the Branch Davidians. The next one was Marshall Applewhite of the Heaven's Gate. Okay. The interesting thing about all those particular ministries, okay, is that every one of them ended up with mass murder or mass suicide. Isn't that an interesting fact? Jesus Christ said, "Watch out that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Christ." We're seeing this in our day. "And will deceive many." You know, it's amazing to me that the human mind is so susceptible to deception. I mean, it's incredible. You think about this. What mind says this? "My name is David Koresh. I am Jesus Christ, come back, reincarnated, or whatever. And you know, I like your wife, so I'm going to take her to be mine. And I like your wife, I'm going to take her to be mine. And you know, that kid's kind of cute, I'm going to take him to be mine. Okay, you do that. You know, the only word I can think of is stupid. Really, stupid, just stupidity. David, you try to date my wife, and we're going to have a problem. Of course, I don't have a wife, so I'm not good. And David's gone. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Christ, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars, armed conflicts. Today there are about 40 of them. And rumors of wars. This is a very interesting word in the Greek. It's called akatastasia. And really, it could be translated, and in the Lunar National, it is translated revolutions. Revolutions. What is that? It's instability, it's disorder, it's riots, it's uprising. And are we seeing that today in our country? We're seeing that today in our country. You know, we see these statues being torn down. Okay, you know, maybe some are, you know, I mean, the guy that was the head of the Ku Klux Klan in Missouri or whoever that, wherever that was, I'm thinking maybe not a statue of him. All right, you know, but this is history. We're supposed to learn from history lest history repeat itself. And these people are trying to destroy the historical record. Why? Well, because if you destroy the historical record of the United States of America, you destroy what makes us free. What makes us free? We have people, men and women, courageous people, that were willing to lay down their lives so that we could be free. And now we have gutless people, cowards, that are going and destroying people, destroying property, picking on policemen who are trying to keep the order. You know, is this a perfect world? No, it is not. Is it a perfect country? No, it is not. But are these people making it any more perfect? Not really. There's a way to let your protests be known. There's a way to change things, but I tell you, this is not the way. Now, what did Jesus do? He said, you will hear of wars and rumors of wars or riots or uprisings or revolutions, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Whoa, that's hard to do. My son's got 4 restaurants in Chicago. They came within 2 blocks of destroying his restaurant. Yeah. Would you be worried? Well, yeah. Yeah. Jesus said, don't be worried. Don't be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation. This would be better translated. Nationality will rise against nationality. You know why? Because the word for nation in the Greek is ethnos. What word do we get from ethnos? Ethnic or ethnicity. Okay? And these are tribes or races that are fighting against each other. Jesus Christ said, nationalities will rise against nationalities. I think about back in, I'm trying to think of the name of it, it's in Eastern Europe, and it was back in the 80s and 90s, where they did a purging of a certain tribal peoples. It has happened everywhere. It's happened in almost every country. It's even happened in the United States of America, if you think about it, when we came over and tried to get rid of the Indians. You know, they were here before us. They had a right to be here. What's that?
Was that Mogadishu?
No, well, it happened up there too, but it was, I don't want to say Slovenia, but it was one of those Ania countries, okay? Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. come, nation or nationality will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. The word for kingdom is basileia, and it means a sovereign country or government. Excuse me. Today, in our life, we're seeing China wanting to take over Taiwan. We're seeing Iran-Iraq hostilities. We're seeing Israel at hostility with almost all of its neighbors. And eventually it will be with all of their neighbors. So we're seeing kingdom against kingdom. The next thing that he says is famines. There will be famines. This is the word limos, and it means destitution or scarcity. You know, on the internet it says that there are roughly 10 million today in the world that are being affected by famines. That's a lot of people, my friends. It's here. The next thing, and Matthew doesn't mention this. I don't know if it was Luke. Let me look at Luke, because Luke was the physician. Maybe he's the one who mentioned it.
Yes, he did.
The in pestilences? Yeah, okay. So Luke, being the physician, mentions pestilences, which is diseases. It's the word loimus, and it means plague. And just in our lifetime alone, AIDS, SARS, COVID. I don't know if you guys knew this, but in the Dark Ages, did you know that the bubonic plague, which was basically spread by rats or rodents, did you know that killed 60% of Europe's population? 60%. It killed almost as many people as World War II killed, which was 50 million. World War II was about 55 million. The next thing that we look at, so we have got all of these signs here today. Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. Earthquakes. Did you know that there are over 55 recorded earthquakes per day of 5.0 magnitude or better? There's over 20,000 earthquakes recorded per year of 5.0 magnitude or better. There's literally way more earthquakes than that, but there's many that are smaller than that. Talk about something that is increasing. Persecutions. They are increasing, not only with Christians, but also with Jews. I heard on the news the other day that last year there was over 1,000 incidences recorded just on college campuses of persecution between Christians and Jews. Think about this. You raise your kid to be a Christian or Jewish, of the Jewish faith. You get him through high school, you send him to college, and he's persecuted in college. What kind of a deal is that? I looked at the 50 top countries for persecution. The top country listed is North Korea. They are the worst. And if I asked you, who would you think would be next or in the top 10? Many of you probably say China, probably Russia. But I don't know if you knew this, but Vietnam is number 21 on the list, and we get a lot of our clothes from Vietnam. China is 23 on the list, and we get a lot of stuff from China. Russia is number 46 on the list, and there's a lot of persecution that goes on in Russia. I don't know. I counted them up. Out of the 50 nations that are the top 50 in persecutions, 39 of them are Islamic nations. 39 out of the 50 are Islamic. That's going to be big. The next thing that I listed was hatred. Hatred. You know, Jesus said that because wickedness increases on the face of this earth, the love of many will grow cold. We have parents that abandon their children, and children that hate their parents. And brothers that hate their sisters and families. It's just terrible. The next thing that I listed was false prophets that claim to be Christ. And we've already talked about that. And there's so much more. I listed quite the list of signs. One of the signs that's going to come that isn't here yet is the abomination that causes desolation. What is that? We read about that in Revelation. We read about that in Daniel. And we have precursors to that. The abomination that causes desolation is when the Jewish temple gets rebuilt. By the way, there's plans to do that. If President Trump's peace plan for the Mideast goes into effect, which they're working on right now, it's very possible that the Temple Mount will be under some type of a shared agreement. They've done surveys of the Temple Mount, and it is believed that the Islamics could keep their Dome of the Rock where it is, and the Temple Mount could be rebuilt on that. I mean, I don't remember how many acres there are, but I think there's 30 or 40 acres up there, and the Temple Mount could be rebuilt without disturbing the Islamic sites. So you can imagine if this peace plan goes through, the next thing that's going to happen is that this Temple Mount is going to come into play to get the temple to get rebuilt. Well, you have to have a temple for the abomination that causes desolation to happen. What is the abomination that causes desolation? It is this. The Antichrist, halfway through the tribulation, is going to go into the Jewish rebuilt temple, and he is going to claim to be God. He's going to claim to be God come in the flesh. In essence, he's going to claim to be God and wants to be worshipped. You can read Revelation chapter 13 because it talks about that. That's going to happen soon. Signs in the heavens. We've had the blood moons. We've had all kinds of different signs. We've got the depletion of the ozone layer. We've got stuff that's going on in the heavens. We've got astronauts right now that are hooking up with the International Space Station. Can you imagine if a country, and don't think this hasn't been under consideration, if a country set up some type of a base, a military base on the moon or on Mars, and you're thinking, oh, that couldn't happen. Guess what? It could happen. Real easily. I mean, not real easily, but it could happen. We've got the technology for it now. And I want to continue to go on in Matthew. Bear with me, okay? So Matthew chapter 24, it says in verse 9, we'll pick it up with persecution, then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn away from the faith and will betray and hate each other. And many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold. But he who stands firm to the end will be saved, and this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all nations, and then the end will come. With the technology that we have today, how long do you think it would be before the gospel is preached throughout the whole world?
I think it already is.
It might be, huh?
Yeah.
It might be. Certainly it is happening. Now, he goes on to say, so when you see standing in the holy place, that would be the temple, the abomination that causes desolation. This happened in 167 B.C. It happened with Antiochus Epiphanes IV, who was a Seleucid king from Syria. Came down. He invaded Israel. He went down into Egypt, caused a bunch of trouble in Egypt. They booted him out of Egypt. He came back up from Israel. He was very, very angry. He went into the Jewish temple. This is Antiochus Epiphanes the Fourth. He ordered that all the sacrifices be stopped, except he had a pig sacrificed in the Holy of Holies, and he had a statue of Jupiter erected in the temple. That was an abomination that causes desolation. The Maccabees, if you read your history and you have a Catholic Bible, which has the book of 1st and 2nd Maccabees in it, it's a very interesting and beautiful story how the Maccabees raised up and they said, no, we're not going to stand for this evil anymore, and they defeated that Seleucid king, ran out of town. That will happen again because history repeats itself. Okay? Now, so we go on real quick and we go down. It says here, then let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. Do you know where Judea is in Israel? We call it the West Bank now. Guess who has control of the West Bank? The Palestinians. The peace plan of Donald Trump is that the Jewish settlements that are already there on the West Bank will become a part of Israel, and this two-state solution, the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, will be united by a road or a tunnel, and they will be the new Palestinian state. Okay? So what he says here, listen to this, he says, remember now, if this peace plan goes through, if the Palestinians are in charge of the West Bank and that becomes the state of Palestine, or what they call it, and if there are Jewish settlements or Jewish people living there, he says this, let those who are in Judea or the West Bank flee to the mountains. Let no one on the roof of his house go down to take anything out of the house. Let no one in the field go back to get his cloak. How dreadful it will be in those days for pregnant women and nursing mothers. Pray that your flight will not take place in winter or on the Sabbath, for then there will be great distress unequaled from the beginning of the world until now and never to be equaled again. If those days had not been cut short, no one would survive. But for the sake of the elect, those days will be shortened. At that time, if anyone says to you, look, here is the Christ, or there he is, do not believe it. For false Christs and false prophets will appear and perform great signs and miracles to deceive even the elect, if that were possible. See, I have told you ahead of time. Read about that in Revelation chapter 13. So if anyone tells you, I want to finish this out. If anyone tells you, there he is, out in the desert, do not go out. Or here he is in the inner rooms, do not believe it. Now Jesus tells us what the sign of his coming will be. For as the lightning that comes from the east is visible even in the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. He goes on, immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened. The moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the nations of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And he sends his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds. You know, the Bible says that the sky will roll up like a scroll. Now, if you've ever seen an atomic blast, okay, and the mushroom cloud goes up and then it rolls like a scroll, okay, something of that nature will happen when Jesus Christ comes back. Every eye will see him. Not one will miss him around the world, don't ask me how, but 360 degrees of the world will see him. I want you to think about this one last scripture. scripture I'm giving you, okay? It might not be the last one, but be close to the last one, okay? This is what he says here, verse 32. Jesus is talking. He says, now learn this lesson from the fig tree. Now, I don't know if you knew this or not, but Israel in the Bible is mentioned as a fig tree and other trees several different times. So he could very well be talking about the nation of Israel here. Learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things, you know that it is near, right at the door. So I tell you this truth. This generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Now, this has been interpreted by conservative scholars as meaning this. The generation that sees the fig tree blossoming and coming forth will be the generation that sees these things happen. Now, in 1948, what happened? May 15th, Israel became a nation. It started blossoming. It was just a pile of rocks in the desert that had been ignored for literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And now when you look at pictures of Israel, or you go over to Israel, it's blooming, it is progressing, it is a viable, visible, thriving country. Could this be what Jesus is talking about here? When this generation sees that fig tree, i.e. the nation of Israel, blooming, that generation will see these things happening. Now, if you were born in 1948, that would make you roughly 71 or 72 years this year, depending on when your birthday is. We've got people in this room right here that were born in that generation. Will that generation see these things happen? Well, all I can say is this. We're seeing a lot of them happen. We're seeing a lot of them happen right now, aren't we? What did Jesus say? He told us several different things at the end of these Matthew 24, Luke 21, and Mark 13. He said, be careful. Be on your guard. Keep watching. Okay? My message today is be careful, be on your guard, and keep watching, because your salvation and your redemption is growing nearer day by day. Let me read one more scripture to you, okay? There's always room for one more scripture, isn't there? Just like there's room for one more brownie. Be very careful then, Ephesians chapter 5 says. Be very careful then how you live. Not as unwise, but as wise. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speak to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Sing and make music in your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Are we to worry? No. Are we to panic? No. Are we to be concerned for our country? Yes. Are we to pray for our president and all of our elected officials?
Yes.
You know, and these folks that are, what do they call it? What are they doing? Protesting. They're protesting. You know, there's a certain percentage of those folks that are legitimately protesting violations of human rights. And that's a good thing. You know, the Bible says to love each other. And, you know, putting your knee on someone's neck for 9 minutes or whatever until they die is probably not loving each other. there is a certain segment that we also need to pray for, and those are the violent types, the one that overthrow. We need them to find the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. Pray with me. Dear Father in heaven, please forgive me for my sins. Cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Help me to be a good citizen of earth, as well as heaven. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's pray. Keep praying for each other. We keep praying for our country. Keep praying for our president. You know, if you don't like Trump, pray for him. Because I guarantee you, whoever gets in next, some people are not going to like him. So pray for him or her too, okay? Whoever that person is. Now we have a song. We got communion. Yes, we do. Okay. Well, let's take communion. I forget it. We'll make it short and sweet. By the way, communion. Very quickly, we are using a new method, just temporarily for communion. We ordered some of these pre-made cups, okay? They can be peeled. Probably gonna want to do that. So, let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for everything you do. We pray that you'll bless this communion service as we remember the precious life and the death of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Father, help us, Lord God, to be the kind of people who want us to be. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh.
You know what? Let's just praise the Lord. Let's just praise the Lord. When we think about the bread, we think about the body of Jesus Christ and his precious life here on the face of this earth. When we think about the cup, we think about the blood that he shed on the cross of Calvary, which wiped away our sins. It is finished, he said. So let's take the bread, the can. I'm not good at this either.
Where's the button?